history of the lumbosacral spine, and now I am speaking about MRI of the lumbosacral spine. I have selected this because this is very important for every practicing physiotherapist, that he understands what he is treating. He should understand very well what he is treating. If he is not understanding it, he will not understand what kind of exercises and physiotherapy you need to give them. You need to understand what pathology is. You need to understand whether the patient has compression of nerve roots or not. You need to understand whether the compression is more in flexion or more in extension. You should understand whether the pathology is coming from the disc or the vertebral body or the ligamentum flavum, because each one is different. All of you know the pain because of discal pathology will increase in sitting position, whereas the pain because of stenosis is relieved in flexion position. So you need to know these differences so that you can give the appropriate exercises. Hope everyone is able to hear me. Can I get an answer if everyone is able to hear me? Yeah. In this seminar, my organization will be in this way. First, we will try to identify the proper sequences. What are sequences? MRI has a number of sequences. We have T1 weighted images, T2 weighted images, we have stir images. We have a number of sequences. So, when the pathology you need to diagnose, for a radiologist, for a neurophysician, for a neurosurgeon, if you have to diagnose the pathology, whether it's a tumor, whether it's an infection, in that you will have to assess each and every sequences. I'm not going to so much of depth. I am going to teach you in a way that you will be able to assess this MRI for common pathologies. So you will have to identify the correct sequence. So of all these sequences, what sequence is important for me, for us, is the T2 weighted sequences. So whenever you are given an MRI of the lumbosacral spine, you will look for T2 weighted sequences. I will be teaching you how to identify the T2 weighted sequences. Fine. T1 weighted sequences, stir sequences, contrast images, fat suppression images, all these are important. But from practical point of view, T2 weighted sequences will suffice. So first step you'll have to identify is what sequences you are looking for. Then you will have to identify the proper cuts. What are the cuts? We have the axial cuts, we have the coronal cuts, and the sagittal cuts. Axial cuts, sagittal, coronal. So you will have to identify the appropriate cuts. Third one in my webinar is you will have to identify the normal structures in the MRI of lumbosacral spine. Unless and until you identify the normal structures, of course, you will not be able to identify the pathology. And fourth part of my webinar will be the identifying the pathology so that you can give them appropriate treatment. Let's start with the planes. I think every one of you know what is axial plane. Axial plane is horizontal or transverse plane. I think every one of you know this. Axial planes, you take a cut this way, you take a cut this way. So axial cuts are horizontal cuts. Both coronal and sagittal cuts are vertical cuts. But sagittal plane goes through the nose, vertically through the nose. So this one is the sagittal cut. It divides the when you take a sagittal cut, it divides the patient into right and left. It goes in the plane of the nose. And what are the coronal plane? The coronal plane is the plane going through the ears. It's parallel to the ears. So it divides our body into anterior and posterior portions. So from practical point of view, what are important for us are the axial cuts and the coronal cuts. From practical point of view, these are the most important cuts which are useful for us, the axial and the coronal. So coming to the plane, so I'm labeling this as A, I'm labeling this as B. So can everyone tell me what is A? Is a sagittal cut or the axial cut? I'm waiting for your answer. So A is Fine. So A is sagittal cuts. Everyone has answered right. That is very sure. And B is? So B is? Yeah, axial cuts. So you will have to identify the axial cut and the sagittal cut. So this is our first one. Second one. So as I told, what was the first part of our webinar? Identify the proper identify the proper cuts. So you have identified the proper cuts. These are the sagittal cuts, these are the axial cuts. Now let us come to second part. Let us read the anatomy first. So quickly, each one of you. So what is A? I want what is B? I want what is C? And I want what is D? Quickly, I want answers. A is body, right? What is B? B is disc, right? What is C? Okay, disc and nucleus pulposus, it's okay. Then what is C? I'm waiting for C. Yeah, C is CSF. What is D? D is spinal cord. Everyone is right. I want you to concentrate on C. So C is CSF. CSF is a white in color. Again, I want you to answer what is A? Okay. What is B? What is C? And what is D? So these are very important. Unless and until you understand this, you will be able to not be able to understand the MRI picture of normal anatomy. So what is A? B is meninges or dural sac. Cry. What is A? C is spinal cord, right? No one is answering A. A is the body. Body are the disc, right? And what is D? D is the nerve root, right? In this picture, I want to give you one thing. This, can you identify? This is our head. This is our trunk. These are our hands. So can you identify this picture? We have a head and both our hands. Okay, this way. The way I have shown you before. We have our head and both our hands. So this is our head. This is our hand. Fine. So many people are having a confusion whether it's spinal canal or dural sac or the meninges or the spinal cord. I will tell you that one. First identify this one. You will have to remember the head. You will have to remember the hands. So the head is concerned with. The head is made up of the outer layer which you are seeing is the dural sac or the meninges. Dural sac is a meninges. It's the dura mater. So the outer one is the dural sac. Which matter? Dura mater. I have told in my first seminar, the outermost layer is the dura mater. The layers which are surrounding the spinal cord are the pia arachnoid matter. Pia arachnoid matter cannot be seen on the MRI. What you are seeing this one is the dura mater. So for the head, again I will draw my head. So the outer layering of my head is the dura mater or the meninges. And what is there inside the dura mater? We'll have the spinal cord. So this one is the spinal cord. Can anyone tell me where does the spinal cord end? Where does the spinal cord end? Yes, spinal cord ends at the level of L1. So if this cut is above the level of L1, what you are seeing this one is the spinal cord. That is either cauda equina or the spinal, not L2, L3. Yeah, either you can say lower border of L1 or superior border of L2, but not L3. Spinal cord ends at the lower border of L1. Not the upper border of L2. It doesn't end at the level of L3. So if within the dural sac, if the axial cut is below the level of L1, if it is above the level of L1, it is the spinal cord or the conus medullaris. And if it is below the level of L1, then what you will be seeing is the spinal roots, which form the cauda equina. Roots, which is the cauda equina, if it is below the level of L1, below L1, and if it is above L1, we'll be finding conus medullaris, that is spinal cord. Okay, so this part of my head is clear. So what is made by this? My hands. So these hands, are you able to recognize? These hands, they form the nerve roots. Dr. Ashish Gupta is asking me, sometimes the spinal cord ends at the level of T12. Never. Normal ending is at the lower border of L1. Any other level is abnormal. If it's below the level of L1, it's a tethered cord. Above the level of L1 is very, very rare, and practically I have never seen. So this, where am I? So these hands, they form the nerve roots. They are the exiting nerve roots with overlying dura mater. With the overlying dura mater. Fine. This picture you'll have to understand. So whatever I've told you is the basics, and this you have to recognize. So what you have seen in the axial cuts and the this one. Here I'm identifying a structure. So each one of you tell me, what is this? What structure I have shown you? We have shown something in this one. So this is the same structure which I'm showing there. So this structure, what is this in the sagittal cut? This is CSF. So CSF here is black. CSF here is white. So all those cuts where CSF is white, this shows this is T2 weighted images. Am I clear? So whenever you see the MRI, you will have to identify the T2 weighted images. So how do you identify the T2 weighted images? You look for the color of CSF. If the color of CSF is white in color, then these are the T2 weighted images. So from now onwards, we will concentrate only on the T2 weighted images. Am I clear? So practically for my physiotherapy, majority of times T1 weighted images are not useful for me. What are useful for me are the T2 weighted images. So, and I'll be following only the T2 weighted images. Now, A and B, which one are T1 weighted image, which one is T2 weighted image? First, tell me which cut it is. This is axial or sagittal. Second one, what is A? A is T1 weighted image or T2 weighted image? I want these answers. A is T1 weighted image. Someone is saying A is T1 weighted image. So cut is axial cut. Everyone is right. Everyone is saying T2 weighted images. Is anyone having a confusion? This is CSF. CSF is white in color. So this is T2 weighted images. We want axial T2 weighted images. Fine. Here CSF is black in color. So this is T1 weighted images. And so we are not looking at T1 weighted images. So we have done two parts of our job. We have identified the cuts which are useful for us. We have identified the axial cuts and sagittal cuts, both of which are useful for us. We have identified the T2 weighted images, which is very useful for me. Now, can anyone tell me this axial cut, which level it is? It is L1, L2, or L2, L3, or L3, L4? R L4 L5. This one, seeing the axial, you have to say which level of the disc is it in what? Can anyone tell me which level it is? L1, L2, or L2, L3, or L3, 4, L4? If you don't know, just type, you can't know. You are not able to say. Fine. Everyone is saying L4, L5, but how did you say it is L4, L5? You cannot make out whether it is L4, L5 or L1, L2 or L2, L3 from the axial cut. You will have to see at the sagittal cut. This is not the scout image. Usually whenever there is an axial cut, the MRI will have a small scout image. This is given over here. This is known as the scout image. From this scout image, you'll have to identify where the cut is. So this cut corresponds to this one. This is L4, L5. So you identify the level of the disc by comparing it with the scout image. Scout image is a small sagittal image which is given as a PIP. If it is not given as a PIP, suppose it's not given as a PIP, what is given is you will have a number of lines over here in the scout image, and each line is given a number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 something, and that number will be written over here. So you'll have to correspond this number to this one and then decide which cut it is. So you will have to identify whether it's T1 weighted or T1 T2 weighted images. Am I being overlapped by the image? I think I will not be able to change it now, but just identify that the level of the disc is made out by corresponding it with the scout image. Either the scout image is given as a PIP over here from which you can make out, Otherwise, the each cut is given a number and that number is displayed over here. So we'll have to correlate these two things to come to a conclusion. It's not struck up, no? Am I good with my speed or should I go slow or fast? Yeah. Next, we will go to the go into the pathology. But before that one, I want you to again revise it. One important thing which I wanted to tell again is, so this one is S1. Everyone can identify the sacrum. This is L5, 4, 3, 2. So what is this one which I am seeing? So let me label it here. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So what is the neural structure over here? A. And what is the neural structure over here? B. What is a neural structure which I have labeled as A? What is a neural structure which I have labeled as B? What is the difference between A and B? A, yeah, all are parts of spinal cord. I want to, which part of spinal cord it is? What is A, what is B? A is conus medullaris. What is B? Dr. Sandesh is saying it's conus medullaris. No. A is a part of spinal cord which is called conus medullaris. It is the lowermost part of the spinal cord. So this is conus medullaris, which is the lower part of the spinal cord. And all these things, these are the nerve roots which are going to neural foramina. This is known as a corda equina. This is known as the corda equina. Am I clear? So A is conus medullaris and B is corda equina. Corda equina is made up of all traversing nerve roots. Now, majority of the normal things I have told you. Now let us come into the disc. Three pathologies are very important for you. One is disc prolapse. The second one is stenosis. We have the lateral canal stenosis and the central canal stenosis. Third one is facet arthritis. Fourth one is spondylolisthesis. So I'll be explaining you all these four things: the disc prolapse, stenosis, facet arthritis, and spondyloarthritis. Can anyone tell me low back pain due to disc prolapse is more in forward flexion or extension? Pain because of lumbar disc prolapse is more in flexion or extension? Next 5 minutes, I'll be a bit slow because this is very important. If you don't understand this pathology, then you will not be able to correlate it with the MRI also. So I'm waiting for your answer. So the pain in disc prolapse is more in forward bending, right? So pain because of disc prolapse is more in forward bending. Fine. Pain in facet arthritis is more in what? Pain in facet arthritis more in. Whenever you are answering, you say disc prolapse, flexion or extension. Facet arthritis, flexion or extension. Otherwise, I will not be able to understand in the chat. I'm waiting for your answer because if you don't understand this one, there is no point in me going forward. No, there is, I have a mixture of these things. So when you are answering, type disc prolapse flexion. Yeah, so disc prolapse, the pain is more in forward bending. Facet arthritis, the pain is more in backward extension. Can anyone tell me what happens with symptomatology of stenosis in forward bending? Symptoms of stenosis increase in what? Forward bending or backward bending? Symptoms of stenosis. Yeah, facet arthritis extension, disc prolapse flexion. Excellent. Everyone is, one of you are answering too good. Disc flexion, facet arthritis. Now come to stenosis. I am happy with facet arthritis and disc. Coming to stenosis. Stenosis, the complaints of stenosis, will they increase in extension or flexion? Right. So the symptoms of stenosis reduce in flexion and increase in extension. And final one, spondylolisthesis. Stenosis, the symptoms increase in extension, they are relieved in flexion. There is no doubt in it. And final, spondylolisthesis. When will the pain increase? In spondylolisthesis, it's variable. To understand spondylolisthesis, we will get a flexion extension films. I've told in the last seminar, if the mobility of one vertebra over the other is more in flexion, patient will have more pain in flexion. If the mobility is more in extension, patient will have more pain in extension. Fine. Dr. Sandesh's answer depends on anterolisthesis or retrolisthesis. So you needn't apply your brain. Ask for an X-ray lumbosacral spine flexion and extension. If the film where the listhesis is more, the mobility is more, the displacement is more, in that position the patient will have more pain. Fine. Very good. Where am I? Both of these are axial cuts. Okay. But this, can you identify the difference in the neural structures here? There's one solid structure over here. There are number of dots like this. What is the difference in the both of them? And I will give you one hint. This is below, above the level of L1. This is at the level of L3, L4. So what is the neural structure here? What is the neural structure in A? Both are neural structures. I have told you in the normal anatomy. Above L1, which neural structure is seen? Right. Above L1 in A, it is this pons medullaris. Conus medullaris is seen as a single structure, whereas this is cauda equina. Cauda equina is seen as dots. Can you identify the dots? Every one of you try to identify the dots on your screen. Actually, I wanted to tell you something. Now coming to the disc, we'll go to independent disc. So this is the disc. The disc has two components. It has an outer component which is like a covering, just like a pillow on your sofa. The sofa has an outer leather covering, and inner you will have cotton. Cotton or sponge or whatever it be. The outer covering is called annulus. The inner layer, inner which looks like sponge or gum, whatever you call it. Dr. Sandesh is asking conus medullaris below L1 or above L1. Conus medullaris is above L1 and cauda equina is below L1. So each disc has an annulus and a nucleus pulposus. Have I shown it over here? Fine. So in this MRI sagittal view, can you identify the annulus? The annulus is black in color. And the nucleus pulposus is white in color in the center portion. Every one of you on your computer screen, draw the annulus and the nucleus pulposus in this cut. At this level, I want every one of you to identify the annulus and the nucleus pulposus and highlight it. Are you able to identify? I want every one of you to draw it L4 and L5, and once you are done, once you are able to identify, answer on the chat. At least 80% of the cases are discal pathologies. So you will have to identify the disc pathology. You will have to identify what is annulus, what is nucleus pulposus. And second one, can anyone tell you why is CSF white in color? On T2 weighted images, why is CSF white in color? Water content, anything which contains water content in our body appears white on T2 weighted images. So CSF is nothing but water. That is why CSF appears white in color. Similarly, a normal disc, the nucleus pulposus is hydrated. This is an hydrated nucleus pulposus. So, a hydrated nucleus pulposus appears white in color. When it gets dehydrated, when a disc starts desiccated, it starts becoming desiccated, these white structures will become black. But the annulus is always white, black in color. Last time I have shown this video. This video I want to see very clearly. At every level, the patient will have different symptoms. So I will play this video twice. So you will have to identify this video twice. First one, I will tell you what happens in a disc pathology. I will replay this video, and at every pathological level, we will identify what symptoms the patient will have. Okay? Let's start. So I'm playing the video. So this is the normal nucleus pulposus. This is the normal annulus. So what happens in step one? Let's see. So what happens in step one? Oh, sorry. It's starting now. So in the step one, there is a crack in the, step one I didn't show you. Step one is dehydration. Step two, there's a crack in the annulus, which is known as annular tear. Step three, the disc has protruded out. So step three is prolapse. Step four is compression of the nerve root. Fifth step is inflammation of the nerve root. Compression and inflammation, you take as fourth steps. So am I clear? We'll go back again. Let's see again. Yeah, let's play this video again because there was some confusion. So identify the four steps. First step, dehydration, which I have not shown you in this picture, but I have explained before. Second step is cracking of the annulus. This is the cracked annulus. Third step is prolapse of the disc without compressing the nerve root. Fourth one is compression of the nerve root leading to inflammation of the nerve root. Sequestration, migration, I will tell you later. Try to identify these four things because this is very important, because this will help you to correlate your symptoms. Let's come again. So, again, let me play this video. Now we will see at each stage what will the patient complain of. Correlate that way. This is very important. So in step one, I'm stopping my video here. This is the level of crack, annular tail. So at this point, what will the patient complain of? You will have to understand. Dr. Krishna is asking me regarding sequestration, protrusion, sequestration, migration, all these are amount of protrusion, there are degrees of protrusion. So at that level, the symptomatology will be same. So I will come to protrusion, sequestration, migration in my next slides. But first, try to identify these four levels. So dehydration, I have learned. Second one is annular tear. So what are the patient symptoms at this? At this point, patient will have diffuse back pain. Diffuse, deep-seated back pain. What is very important is, it is very diffuse. When you ask the patient to tell where your pain is, patient will have pain. Dr. Sandesh is saying there is no pain. No. This annular tear which I am showing here will cause pain. He will have only low back pain, but characters of low back pain is one. Back pain is diffuse. When you ask the patient to tell back pain where it is, he will use his entire palm and say, my entire back is paining. But he will not say where exactly the pain is. Fine. If you ask him to localize the pain with one finger, he will not be able to localize the pain. And if we identify some point, if you press it, there will not be any tender spot. So this part, when there is a tear in the annulus, the patient will have diffuse, deep-seated back pain. Second one, and this pain will increase in flexion. So you have to identify this in diffuse, and the pain increases in flexion. Second one, will the patient have radicular pain? No. At this point, patient will have no radicular pain. Am I clear? Yes. Let me play this video for the next step again. Yeah, we will better play over here. So, coming to the next step, yeah, I'm stopping here. So, what are the symptoms here? This is second step. So, we have a prolapse. This is second one. We have a prolapse, but no nerve root compression. But at this point, patient will have dural compression of the thecal cell. So what will the patient complain of pain now? Now the patient will have low back pain plus deep gluteal pain. This deep gluteal pain is because of the compression on the thecal sac, not on the nerve roots. These are nerve roots in the neural foramina, but in the center you have the thecal sac. So this is a deep gluteal pain because of pain. No, even in this point, patient will have deep gluteal pain. He will not be able to localize again. So this is the second stage. Let us go to third stage. Fourth one, I mean to say. Now in the fourth one, so patient has compression. patient has inflammation of the nerve root. So what will patient complain of now? Now the patient will have low backache pain along with radicular pain. So what is radicular pain? Patient will have pain from the gluteus, from the back to the So am I clear? I think so. Let's go to the next one. I have difficulty in playing these videos. So when there is a prolapse, patient will have radiating pain. Radiating pain is pain along the buttocks radiating to the thigh or the sole. So now let us come to the next pathology, that is facet arthritis. So these are the facet joints. So what happens in facet arthritis?
Because the facet joints are almost constantly in motion, they simply degenerate from...
I have taken this video from the internet. And strains over time. So if you can type the Atlantic Spine Center, you will find this on internet. This I wanted... This is a very good animation, so I wanted to show it. So these are the facet joints. Facet joints and this degeneration are usually seen together. This
results in inflammation and formation of spinal bone spurs.
So there is inflammation of the facets, irregularity of facets. This is similar to osteoarthritis of the knee.
Arthritic joints can produce considerable pain and reflective muscle spasms.
So, what I wanted to show, tell is the patient in facet arthritis pain will be only low backache. Radicular pain can be seen but very rare. Second one, but this pain is localized. Patient will be localizing that pain to the paraspinal region. If you ask the patient to see, he will use a thumb and say, typically patients will come to the OPD. I'm not sure whether they're able to see me, but probably can you see me this way? The patient will come to the OPD and they say, this is my back pain, and I'll use a thumb and show my pain is here. I'm not sure if you are able to see in the camera or not. They localize 1 or 2 points in the paraspinal region. So this is pain because of facet arthritis. So everyone should be able to differentiate pain because of disc bulge, that is pain because of annular tear, from the pain because of facet arthritis. Low backache in facet arthritis increases in extension. It is more localized and the patient will be able to localize it with the finger. He will typically show, this is my pain. Facet arthritis is a clinical diagnosis. Many times patient with facet arthritis will be roaming about. People will be saying, you have psychiatric symptoms, there is nothing on the scan, because facet arthritis is very difficult to identify on the scan. Facet arthritis is a clinical diagnosis. The surgical and medical and physiotherapy management of facet arthritis is completely different from the management of disc prolapse or spondylolisthesis. So you will have to examine the patient and make sure patient has pain because of facet arthritis or no. Sometimes patient will have both the components, discal pain and also facet arthritis. So it becomes your responsibility. Sir, is it the only reason pain or any other reason? Dr. Kirti, can you elaborate? I'm not very sure. Yeah, and Dr. Soumya is asking, when should I refer the patient for MRI? Dr. Soumya, my next presentation is not next, after 2-3, maybe after 4th or 5th session, when I'm teaching you practical aspects, I'm going to tell you when you have to give physiotherapy, when will you go for medical management, when will you go for surgery. So in that part, in that topic, I will tell you when you should refer the patient for MRI. Basically, you can say that you can, in short, you refer the patient for MRI when the pain is not decreasing even after 1 or 2 months of physiotherapy, or if the patient has sensory deficits or the neurological deficits. Sir, Dr. Keith is asking me, sir, is the only reason for pain or any other reason, the pain is in this paraspinal. Yes, facet arthritis pain. All the pains are paraspinal region, but in facet arthritis, the pain in paraspinal region is very localized. You can localize it with the finger. Next. So what is this pathology? Spondylolisthesis. In this, patient will have both back pain and radicular pain. And on palpation, there will be strep deformity. And this is very easy to diagnose with the flexion extension images. Flexion extension x-rays. No investigation of a patient with lumbosacral spine. No investigation of lumbosacral spine is complete with a flexion extension image of x-ray. It's a common thing is if the patient has got an MRI, why should I ask for an MRI for an x-ray? Listhesis mobility is seen only in dynamic x-rays. So for every patient will get a dynamic x-ray. Dr. Kirti is asking me questions are too many. Probably I will try to answer these questions in the end. Okay, let me complete my presentation. So coming to nerve radiology. So when what is the normal shape of the disc in the axial cut? Normal shape of the disc is this way. That is, posteriorly there is a concave surface. This is normal. Okay. So types of disc herniation. You can have a diffuse disc bulge. So that is the concavity is lost. We can have a focal disc bulge. That is very small portion of the disc is prolapsed. Usually we say less than 20% or 30%. What is sequestered disc? When the disc is separated from the original fragment. Can you see this one? This is a normal concave structure. So in an MRI, the normal concavity is lost. So this is a diffuse disc bulge. This is a focal disc bulge here. So there is a focal disc bulge here. Sequestered disc. There is loss of continuity between the original disc and the disc fragment. Can you see this one? The L5S1 disc has moved upwards and it's not continuous with the original fragment. This is a migrated disc. That's the disc will either grow, move up or move down, but the continuity with the original fragment is maintained. So someone was asking what is sequestered and migrated disc. So probably I'm clear. All these things are important from MRI point of view. So you will have to identify where, which level the disc is, whether the disc is a diffuse or focal or sequestered or migrated. And one more thing you will have to identify is, so just now I have shown, this is my head, which is made of the thecal sac and the spinal cord. And these are my hands. So these hands are the exiting nerve roots. So this exiting nerve root has three components. Okay, this one is known as the lateral recess. This one is the lateral, exact the shoulder joint. The shoulder joint is known as the lateral recess. This one is the pedicle. So the one at the level of pedicle is known as the foraminal zone. And the one outside the foramen is known as the extraforaminal zone. This entire portion is known as the central canal. So it's very easy. Center portion is central canal. The lateral one, just below my shoulder. You can say something at the junction of my neck and my shoulder. That is known as the lateral recess. So this one is the lateral recess. Remaining portion is the foraminal zone, and outside the pedicle, outside the foramen, is the extraforaminal zone. Dr. Krishna is asking me what is a migrated disc. See, I'll have to show you. So this is the level of L5S1. So migrated disc, the disc will come out, it will either move up are moved down, but it will not lose continuity with the original one. Again, a few more images I will show you, the bigger images. So I hope all of you have understood this one. So focal disc bulges, you will have to label them. So this is a midline. So this is a medial focal disc bulge. This is a foraminal disc bulge. This is the foramen. This is the extraforaminal disc bulge. So I think all these things are easy. Now let us read the MRI. Leave your questions aside. I will come to your questions. The next few slides, I want only interaction. I have told you everything. It's now your job to identify and answer me. So can you identify this A is a normal disc, B is a degenerated disc. Why? What will be the color of nucleus pulposus in B? What is the color of nucleus pulposus in B? Is there a, is it buffering or is the image clear? Yeah. So this structure, the nucleus pulposus has become, is there any problem? I am getting a message as show and hide. I don't know, what does it mean? Everyone is showing show and hide. I don't know what is the message mean. Dark. So except for one person, everyone has shown the nucleus pulposus in this level has become dark. So this means the disc is dehydrated. Desiccated. So what happened to alpha S1? So what are the findings here? Here, one is the disc is dehydrated. Second one is it's prolapsed. Am I clear? Next. Identify again here. I have told you, you will have to identify the stenosis. There is compression in the center part of the disc. So this is central stenosis. But sometimes there will be hypertrophy of the ligamentum flavum or hypertrophy of the facet joint. Or a foraminal disc bulge. All this will cause lateral canal stenosis. So this is known as lateral stenosis. This is the central stenosis. Central stenosis, the symptoms are bilateral. Lateral stenosis, the symptoms are unilateral. Fine. This is classical picture you can find on the internet. All the things are shown in one picture. This is a normal disc. This is a dehydrated disc which becomes black in color, decrease in height. This is a bulging disc. This is herniated disc, and these are the osteophytes which can also cause back pain. So can you identify again the disc has become black in color? So this is an example of disc dehydration or disc desiccation. Yeah. Now this structure is very important. Okay. Now tell me, what is the color of the disc? What is the color of the disc? I'm identified. Second one, what happened to the annulus? I mean to say, what is the color of the pulposus? What happened to the annulus? Dr. Fatima is asking me, is disc desiccation reversible? Sometimes, but usually they are not. If in the early stages, we can, but usually not. So the pulposus, what happened to pulposus? What happened to annulus? Pulposus has become gray. So there is dehydration. What happened to the annulus? What happened to the annulus? Can everyone see this arrow? This is an annular tear. This is an annular tear. And this is seen as an hyper in this is called HIZ. This is known as an hyperintense zone. Zone on T2 weighted MRI. So can you identify second stage of disc herniation? That is annular tear. At this point also patient will have, if there is an acute annular tear, patient will have severe back pain. Many of the people may say MRI is normal, but if you look at the MRI, you can identify the hyperintense zone, which is the annular tear. So what happened now? The annular tear has come out, and now the patient, what will patient, and this is the thecal sac. So it is also compressing the thecal sac. So the patient will have low backache. He will also have deep gluteal pain. The deep gluteal pain is because of compression of the dural sac. So let's go to third one. What can you tell me the diagnosis? First, tell me which disc is involved. Level. Second, tell me is it prolapse or migrated or sequestered? I'm waiting for your answers. Is buffering good for you, for everyone? Because my own mobile is buffering always. Deep gluteal pain can be bilateral or unilateral, but usually unilateral on the side of the annular tear. But it doesn't always correlate. Sometimes annular tear is on the right side, but the patient has pain on the left side. So level is L4, L5. Right. Second one, is it prolapse or migration or sequestration? Dr. Veerabhadram has said sequestration. But what is a sequestered disc? First level, is there any confusion? This is S1. This is L5. This is L4. So the level of the disc is L4, L5. Second one, the disc has gone down. So this is caudally migrated. Third one, there is a continuity between the original vertebra and the disc. So this is not sequestered. Right. Again, level, I want level, I want prolapse or migration or sequestered. So L4, L5 migrated. Caudally migrated or cranial migrated? Caudal or cranial? L4, L5 migrated and it's cranial migration because it has gone up, and you can see the continuity, so it's not sequestered. Let's go to the next one. Again, tell me the level. This is S1, this is L5, this is L4. This is L3, this is L2. So this has gone up. So this is L3, L4 disc. This is sequestered. It has lost the continuity. And also, in addition to sequestered, it has cranially migrated. Fine. We'll go to next one. Now come into axial cuts. So in the axial cuts, tell me, this is nucleus pulposus. Is it dark or white? This is dark. So this disc is dehydrated. What is this one? This is a focal disc bulge on which side? This is there on the right side. And third one is a midline or paracentral midline or paramedian or foraminal or extraforaminal. So this is a dehydrated, this is a focal disc bulge on the right side, and this is paramedian. So answer is paramedian disc bulge. Fine. This one, this one, is it median or paramedian or central? I meant to say median or extraforaminal or foraminal. Someone is saying foraminal disc bulge. This is the level of foramina. No, this is the level of foramina. So this is not a foraminal disc bulge. This is a central disc bulge. Median, right? This is a median disc bulge. This one, this is an, you're right, this is an extraforaminal disc bulge. This is extraforaminal. If it is at this level, if it is at this level, see, these are the pedicle. So if it is at this level, it is foraminal. Lateral to this one is the extraforaminal. Right, this is left extraforaminal disc bulge. This one, there is single disc bulge at two levels. No, you can say this is paramedian plus foramina. Left. So there is also a median actually. There is a big disc bulge. There is a median bulge. There is a paramedian bulge and there is also foraminal bulge. So this patient has all a single fragment which is at all the three levels. This one, same, mild median, very big paramedian and foraminal. Again, this one is right. I am very sure you will be easily able to say this is a median disc bulge. Can you identify what are these pathologies? These are the osteophytes. These are the osteophytes. See, what I have to want to show is, in this picture I am speaking about stenosis. Stenosis may be because of disc bulge, It may be because of facet type hypertrophy. It may be because of ligamentum flavum hypertrophy. Ligamentum flavum hypertrophy. Sometimes it may be because of foraminal osteophytes also. Any of this thing can cause stenosis. Stenosis causes paresthesias, numbness, motor deficits. So we will have to see whether every patient has central stenosis or the foraminal stenosis. Can you see here at the foraminal level, the shoulders? What I've shown you in our center one, this is my head, this is my shoulder. So at the shoulder, there is you are not able to see the nerve root. See, this is my thecal sac, this is my shoulder. Are you able to see my shoulder? That is narrow. So this is lateral canal stenosis. So this is lateral canal stenosis. Can you identify here? So this patient has central canal stenosis or lateral canal stenosis? Central or lateral? Central or lateral? Central is normal. You can see entire thecal sac is seen, nerve roots are seen. But here you can see the shoulder is obliterated. So this patient has right side, the shoulder is normal. So the patient has left lateral canal stenosis. And that is because of a foraminal disc bulge. Again, the same picture, the patient has a central disc bulge causing mild central stenosis and a significant lateral stenosis. This picture has both, this patient, both central canal stenosis and the lateral stenosis, but lateral stenosis is more severe. This is normal. Now coming to facet arthritis. This is very difficult to identify from the MRI. Sometimes MRI will show facet arthritis, but patient will not have symptoms of facet arthritis. Sometimes MRI will not show facet arthritis, but patient will have symptoms of facet arthritis. So facet arthritis is mainly a clinical diagnosis. But on radiology MRI, you can see that these are the facet joints. They are usually white because of well-hydrated cartilage. But in facet arthritis, there is hypertrophy of the joint, there's a desiccation, but you needn't be so good at it. You can just facet arthritis a clinical diagnosis. So don't try to diagnose on the MRI. Don't look an MRI on an MRI for facet arthritis. If it's given the report, it's well and good, but you identify facet arthritis clinically. Although radiologically you can identify this patient as facet arthritis, but facet arthritis is a clinical diagnosis. What diagnosis they have, I will not even write on this one. You can easily say patient has what. I think I'm done. CT scan of the lumbosacral spine is not very important. We will not go into these details. So let me see your questions. Let me answer. From the beginning. And because this is on YouTube, this will automatically get recorded. So I will be sending you the link immediately. Now coming to your questions. When I'm going through, I'm only finding answers. There are not many questions.
CSF, T1, T2, T2, answer, cancel, answer, answer.
Okay, what is PIP? People are asking that is picture in picture. The way you see in a TV, the way you are saying, it is seeing my picture in your one. You are able to see my PowerPoint presentation with my photograph. Physio Plexus Academy was asking me. So that is my picture in picture. Exactly when you use an MRI, the way you are seeing on my screen, the place where you are seeing my picture, there will be a small sagittal cut which is given with a horizontal line. That is known as Scott image. That horizontal line shows the level of disc, the level of the axial cut. I think I have answered majority of thing. Dr. Malaya Ranjan is asking ligamentum flavum hypertrophy is included in which condition? Ligamentum flavum hypertrophy causes central canal stenosis and lateral canal stenosis. I'm not finding any questions. All are answers only. In the meantime, if you have any other questions, you can type in the chat. Yes, Dr. Sandesh is asking in facet joint, in facet arthritis, is there reduction in fluid in the joint? Exactly. This is exactly the pathology which you see in osteoarthritis of the knee. Classical symptom of facet joint arthritis is right. The low backache is sometimes more in the morning, but not always. And it is also more when the patient extends and does the daily activities. Migrated disc, Dr. Krishna was asking, I have shown you a number of pictures. I think that should be okay. Sequestration. I think there are not many. Yeah, now fine. If you have any other questions, you can ask me now. Yeah, Dr. Ashish Gupta is asking, sir, if there's stenosis because of disc bulge, pain will increase in flexion or extension. This is an important question, but stenosis will cause more of symptoms which are like paresthesias, burning sensation, okay, and disc bulge will be more of pain. So when a disc bulge causes more of stenosis symptoms, if the disc bulge is acute, when the disc bulge is acute, patient will have low back pain and the radicular pain, which is more in flexion. Whereas in a chronic disc bulge, patient will have mild back pain, which may increase in flexion, but patient will more of have radicular pain, which will increase in, which will increase in extension. Patient will have numbness, patient will have paresthesia, which are more in extension. Dr. Ashwin is asking, can we explain median, paramedian? Yeah. It's very simple. See, in an axial cut, these are the pedicles. Okay. If it is in the median, it's not exactly seen here. So if it is exactly in the midline like this, it's median. If it is slightly lateral to the midline, it's paramedian. As simple as that. Midline is medium, just lateral to median is a paramedian. Annular tear, what is the mechanism of pain in flexion? The intradiscal pressure is maximum in flexion. It's maximum when the patient is sitting, middle when the patient is standing, and minimal when the patient is supine. That is why either because of disc dehydration or the annular tear, the pain is more in flexion. Yes, Physio Plexus Academy is asking, MRI findings are not reliable. Yes. MRI will have a number of findings, but you will have to correlate the MRI findings, that is radiological finding, with the clinical finding. Suppose the patient has L3, L4, L4, L5, alpha aspirin. Then you will correlate the radicular pain, the dermatome of the radicular pain with the MRI findings. So MRA doesn't have a role without clinical examination. You'll have to correlate both of them. Dr. Fatima is asking, with many of the complaints of unbearable pain in the morning and intensity is a bit lower throughout the day and activities, are you asking me how do I diagnose or how do you manage? Management, I will teach you in the next one. How do you diagnose this? Same, you'll have to examine the clinical one, correlate with the radiological one, and the patient is complaining predominant symptoms in the morning, we'll also have to rule out rheumatological disorders. No, if the patient has symptoms of both disc bulge and lateral listhesis, you cannot differentiate. You will have to treat for both of them. And usually lateral listhesis is almost always associated with the disc bulge. Diagnosis of the last slide is spondylolisthesis. Grade 3 spondylolisthesis. This is grade 1 spondylolisthesis. MRI, physioplex is asking what is sensitivity of MRI. The sensitivity of MRI is very good. You can say more than 95-96%. But specificity is low. If you find a finding on MRI, you can't say that is the cause of pain. Whatever findings you find on MRI, you will have to correlate it with the clinical thing and assess whether that is the cause of pain or not. Yeah. Older MRI, XR and X-ray can be related, they can be, but usually we get a fresh MRI if the symptoms are of new onset. I think all the questions I have done. So let me stop my presentation now. In the next Friday, I will try to present some other practical aspect from neurology. Probably I will try to teach some specific condition rather than radiology. Thank you. So in the next session will be on Tuesday, where I will be teaching. Maybe I will continue with the functional aspects of cerebrum, which I have stopped in between last time. And should I continue the last one or should I teach you a new one? Just put it on the group so that I will know whether I should teach a specific session or continue with the last one. Retrolisthesis is when the caudal segment has gone back. Antolisthesis is when it has gone front. It's only the direction. So thank you everyone. Thank you all. This presentation, I will immediately put it on YouTube. By today night or tomorrow morning, you will get it. Kindly subscribe to my channel so that you will immediately get an information when I upload the video, and kindly inform your friends so that they can also come to my seminar. It may be useful for them. And if you have any doubts, you can directly contact me on my WhatsApp number or you can WhatsApp on the group. Thank you for today. Thank you and good night.